5. Welcome to this week's episode of Bigfoot for Breakfast, home of the mysterious and the macabre, where we sit in the basement every week challenging conventional thought. In the spirit of Thanksgiving, we would love to express how thankful we are that you have chosen to listen to our little show. And as always, if you are so inclined, please drop a rating and a review on whichever platform you listen from. And don't forget to share us with your friends. If you want to get a hold of us for any reason, whether it be for a show suggestion, a comment, constructive criticism, or if you just want to chit chat about whatever, you can email us at bigfootforbreakfast@outlook.com. You can message us on Facebook, Instagram, or the Twitter, or you can just call and leave us a good old-fashioned voicemail. The number to do that is 641-812-2635. And don't worry, it's just a voicemail, so you don't have to worry about one of us picking up the phone and dragging you into an awkward conversation. This time of year is the time for family, joy, and giving thanks. But you know us, we're going to use it to talk about something weird and dark. So forgive us if we get anything wrong here, folks. Basically, there is the story that we have always learned, and then there are other versions and speculation from different sources that we are going to get into. So remember that some of this is speculation in our sources, and we're going to go ahead and include it as something to think about. So let's dive right in.
That's right, folks. If you haven't already figured it out or made the assumption based on the day of the release, we're going to talk about Thanksgiving, and not in all the good, warm, and fuzzy ways that it's usually talked about. There are some rather dark elements to it, although it really has turned out to be a rather beautiful holiday in which family gathers, remembers their loved ones, talks about old times, has a few laughs, and shares a great big meal that everyone is super thankful for. The actual root of the holiday is not so happy and lighthearted. It is generally believed that American Thanksgiving is modeled on a harvest feast between the colonists of Plymouth and the Wampanoag and Poconoket people in the year 1621. And we're gonna get into that, but let's start more towards the beginning of this whole situation, shall we?
The Pilgrim settlers first stepped off the boat in 1620 and stepped ashore the land of what would later become America, their first footfalls landing on Plymouth Rock, according to legend. But alas, we have a fun fact. The records of the Puritans never once mentioned the landmark that would have been Plymouth Rock at all. Also, they were initially supposed to have two ships back in England. They ended up having a bunch of trouble with one of them, so everyone from that ship had to pack all of their stuff and their families onto the other ship, the good old Mayflower, completely overcrowding it and then making the long journey to the New World. By the time they got there in December, they were sick, weak, and half starved to death, but they still had to face the winter. A lot of them didn't survive.
There they were, staring at a brand new future, a beautiful and vast expanse of empty land that would become their new home. Their hopes and dreams would lay a great foundation as they worked their way toward a new start, away from the Church of England that had oppressed them so, a church that they did not accept anymore. They didn't seek minor changes in the Church of England. They didn't seek to reform or purify it. They left it behind and abandoned it to begin anew here. They were farmers and builders and wanted to live and worship as they pleased.
They were a very religious type, the Pilgrims.
So this was only about 100 years after King Henry VIII established the Church of England when he separated from the Catholic Church in order to have a legal divorce from his first wife, Catherine.
Yep, and the Puritans didn't really necessarily believe in the same things that the Church of England did, and apparently living in England and not believing things Henry VIII believed in was a big old deal, and it was incredibly oppressive. So they left. They blew that popsicle stand. At least that's how it's normally told. But their arrival to Plymouth actually sounded a whole lot more dismal. According to the diary of William Bradford, who detailed this experience meticulously, he actually wrote, quote, "Being thus arrived in a good harbor and brought safe to land, they fell upon their knees and blessed the God of heaven who had brought them over the vast and furious ocean and delivered them from all the perils and miseries thereof. Again, to set their feet on the firm and stable earth, their proper element. But here I cannot stay and make a pause, and stand half amazed at this poor people's present condition. And so I think will the reader too, when he considers the same. Being thus past the vast ocean and sea of trouble before in their preparation, they had now no friends to welcome them, or inns to entertain or refresh their weather-beaten bodies, no houses, or much less towns to repair to. It is recorded in Scripture as a mercy to the apostle and his shipwrecked company that the barbarians showed them no small kindness in refreshing them, But these savage barbarians, when they met with them, were readier to fill their sides full of arrows than otherwise. And for the season, it was winter, and they that know the winters of that country to be sharp and violent, and subject to cruel and fierce storms, dangerous to travel to known places, much more to search an unknown coast. Besides, what could they see but a hideous and desolate wilderness, full of wild beasts and wild men, and what multitudes there may be of them, they knew now. Neither could they, as it were, go up to the top of the Pisgah to view from this wilderness a more goodly country to feed their hopes, for which way soever they turned their eyes, save upward to the heavens, they could have little solace or content in respect of any outward objects. For summer being done, all things stand upon them with a weather-beaten face, and the whole country, full of woods and thickets, represented a wild and savage hue. If they looked behind them, there was the mighty ocean, which they had passed, and was now as a man bar and gulf to separate them from all the civil parts of the world.
Fun fact, the first killer in America was said to have stepped onto land off of the Mayflower. His name was John Billington, and although he was aboard the Mayflower, he wasn't one of the pilgrims. He was part of another group called the Strangers, not the most religious group of people, unlike the Pilgrims. Billington and his family were in and out of trouble with the group and the people of the settlement for years, and about 10 years after arriving to America, he ended up in an argument with another man. So he hid in the woods and ambushed the man while he was hunting, murdering him. It would later become the first trial and death sentence of a murderer in America. At the end of the month, the settlers hung Billington from a tree until he died. I would say it's not necessarily likely that he was the first killer or murderer in America. Probably the first one caught, tried, and hanged.
Indeed. I think they just meant the first murderer who killed another one of them on purpose and was caught, tried, and hanged. Because you know they were killing the Native Americans like crazy. And that is murder as well.
Meow-huh.
Meow-huh. But anyway.
Back to the Pilgrims. They were just stepping off the Mayflower. So while the Pilgrims were probably feeling content and accomplished in escaping the Church of England and getting started on an establishment of their own, in which they could live peacefully how they wanted, the overwhelming reality had just set in as they stepped ashore their new home. They had just endured a journey by ship full of hardship and starvation, watching their comrades die all around them. All this only to be greeted by total wilderness that was unknown to them. They had to build enough of a community to survive the winter from scratch, ration what little food they had left from the ships, and see if there was anything that they could eat among these unknown plants that they had never seen before. Hopefully there would be something to hunt as well, but they didn't really know about that either. On top of that, they quickly noticed that there were other people here, and these other people didn't seem too excited about the newcomers. So what would they expect from them? They had just endured an incredible journey only to face yet another one, that may be even harder, a winter in an unknown land.
You know, actually, the Pilgrims settled first in Holland before they came to America. And in Holland, they actually encountered complete religious tolerance, like unheard of religious tolerance for their time period. But the reason that they left had nothing to do with the religious freedom. So technically, you could say that was the reason they left England, but not necessarily why they came to America. They found it very difficult to survive in Holland. It was a hard place to make a living for them. And yeah, they also had a hard time in that country maintaining their identities as Englishmen.
Another one of these men had a diary too where they talked about Holland, and they actually were the less tolerant ones. The Puritans were, or the Pilgrims were, because they didn't like the things that were being taught to their children in Holland. They thought they were too liberal, basically. And so they took them out of there, and they just wanted to raise their kids without all of that influence, any outside influence.
They were definitely a humorless lot.
Yes, they were. I don't think they had much of a, they didn't have a lot of fun.
And very goth and emo in their fashion choices.
They were angsty, I think.
Totes.
Yeah, but they were tough. I wouldn't have wanted to be on that boat with all that scurvy and end up here trying to build houses out of timbers in the middle of the snow. And I don't like snow at all. I would have been whiny. I would have been a whiny bitch the whole time.
So you would have been the same as you always are?
In the snow, yes.
Truth.
It wouldn't have changed at all.
Nobody likes snow.
No. If it touches me, I'm upset. It's wet and it's cold and I hate it.
So this horrible time period in December in America was called the starving period, aptly.
Yeah.
According to the diary of a man named William Bradford, that we mentioned before. Another fun fact is that some people consider this diary to be the first American history book ever written. Of this time, Bradford wrote, quote, "But that which was most sad and lamentable was that in 2 or 3 months' time, half of their company had died, especially in January and February, being the depth of winter and wanting houses and other comforts, being infected with the scurvy and other diseases which this long voyage, in their inaccommodate condition, had brought upon them. So as there died sometimes 2 or 3 of a day in the foresaid time, that of 100 and odd persons, scarce 50 remained." End quote. He went on to talk about how most of the people who hadn't died were incredibly sick. The rest of the people who were somewhat healthy took great pains to care for their sick and never complained about it in the least. Quote, "And all this willingly and cheerfully, without any grudging in the least, showing herein their true love unto their friends and brethren, a rare example and worthy to be remembered." End quote.
According to historians, people were dying not only of starvation but of rampant disease as well. Likely from being overcrowded on that boat for so long, scurvy and pneumonia were a big deal, and their lack of proper nutrition did a huge amount of damage to their immune systems. While Bradford referred warmly to the pilgrims who were helping the sick at risk to their own health, he also talked about others who cursed the sick for the misfortune of the group, saying, "Let them die."
Probably because they were hungry.
Well, turns out there were actually two groups of people on the Mayflower, and I don't know if it came from the fact that there were two boats initially and they had to mesh together, but there was the strangers and then there was the pilgrims, and they were vastly different types of people. There's these solemn, super religious, I mean, very conservative people, and then there's kind of some regular, not very religious, maybe some troublemaker type people who are not very conservative at all. So they all got, you know, entangled together. So I think while the pilgrims were taking care of people and taking care of their own, they were also probably the ones blaming the other group, you know, in their way of life for why they were being punished by God, in a way, is what I kind of interpreted as. So some of those people, they were like, just let them go. It's probably best. Which isn't really very nice, but that's what was going on.
In this diary, he talks about the Native Americans and how all winter they would see them hanging around but would never approach the pilgrims, and the pilgrims never approached them. The pilgrims, being sick and weakened, were pretty nervous about an attack by the Native Americans because it would have been a total massacre. The pilgrims were in no state to fight off anyone. They were so nervous, in fact, that they would prop dead bodies up against trees, tying muskets into their hands. So from a distance, the Native Americans would think that they had a whole bunch of men standing guard. Basically, the pilgrims didn't push their luck and the Native Americans never attacked. It seemed as though the Native people were mostly investigating them to see what they were all about.
Eventually, they began to seem more interested in what the pilgrims were doing. The way they talked, how they used tools, the tools themselves, the pilgrims' customs. By March, one of the brave Native Americans decided to take a chance and they went right up into the pilgrims' camp. This man could actually speak some English, which really surprised the pilgrims. It turns out, this particular man, named Samoset, had been living more east of there and had made friends with some of the settlers there, and this is where he picked up some of that English. They were really glad to be able to communicate. More and more Native Americans came and met the pilgrims, including Squanto, who spoke fantastic English. They were getting acquainted, and it was peaceful.
We all know the stories of how the first Thanksgiving came to pass, that is taught to the innocent schoolchildren. During the pilgrims' time of need, the local Native Americans came to their aid, teaching the pilgrims how to grow, harvest, and store food, to build for the weather, and find resources. This was mostly thanks to Squanto, who they had befriended. He taught them everything they needed to know and taught them how to survive in the harsh new world. He had his own horror story at the hands of the English. According to stories, Englishmen had come almost 10 years prior to the pilgrims, and one of them tricked Squanto and another native into getting onto their ship. They ended up kidnapping him and taking them clear to England to sell him as a slave. Apparently, he fell in with a fisherman and ended up on various expeditions with him. At some point, he came back to America with a group and landed at Cape Cod, which wasn't far from his original home. He took that golden opportunity to escape and came back to his home to find every single one of his tribe members and his family dead from disease. He was taken by another nearby tribe, and this is how he came to meet the new English people and how he knew enough of the English language to communicate with them. So I'd say that was somewhat fortuitous. for him. I mean, yeah, it sucks to be kidnapped and taken to another country, but also, I don't know, I guess if you'd consider it a good thing that your whole family died and you survived, or if you'd rather died with your family, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. It'd be hard to make that decision for another person. I feel like they're both pretty bad. So that fall, after the harvest was over and everyone was set for the winter, they all got together to celebrate this huge win with a grand feast, attendees of which was said to include an estimated 90 men from the Wampanoag tribe and 50 or so surviving Mayflower passengers, according to an article from Time. It is reported that the party lasted 3 days and featured an indulgent menu which included deer, fowl, and corn, according to an article in Smithsonian Magazine. It is not recorded, however, whether the natives were invited or if they just crashed the party, in the history of either group. Thanksgiving is celebrated on the fourth Thursday of November and had originated as a harvest festival. The holiday was made official in 1863 by President Abraham Lincoln post-Civil War. But apparently, they'd been having Thanksgivings for years and years and years and years before they made it an official deal. And I can't remember the name of the girl, but she kept writing to all the presidents and asking for it to be made an official holiday. And finally, Abraham Lincoln was the first one to do it, and he set the date for it, because usually everyone in the region would just kind of figure out, you know, make plans for which day to have Thanksgiving. But either way, everyone was having one. So they just made it a national holiday, set a day for it every year so that it could be recognized across America, or what small amount of America there was then.
Wow. Wow. There are contradicting tales, however, that the tradition of the Thanksgiving feasts predate Plymouth. I don't know if you've noticed by now, but there's a lot of perceived misinformation going around in the approved course materials for American History 101. Like Columbus being the first to discover America. Or like Abraham Lincoln not being a vampire hunter.
Bullshit.
I know it's true. Mm-hmm. According to a Washington Post article by Gillian Brockell in 2017, based on the tale between the Native Americans and the European immigrants sharing a feast after giving thanks for all of their blessings, is actually true. He says that it just didn't happen in Plymouth or in 1621. There are actually three possible locations and dates for the first official Thanksgiving, which include Maine in 1607, Texas in 1598, or Florida in 1565.
American history during this time period is fraught with mystery.
Fraught.
Which, of course, are the things we love and excel in. One of my favorite of these colonial tales is that of Roanoke Island, because we can't limit this to only Thanksgiving. We got to get into, like, just creepy colonial stuff, right?
It's just macabre American history.
That's what we're doing. So, this does take place right around the time of these suggested first Thanksgivings, so let's go ahead and discuss it. That's right, we're all over the place in this relative time period, folks. Considered to be one of America's oldest unsolved mystery cases, the enigmatic tale can trace the settlement's origins to the year 1587. But the first attempts to explore Roanoke Island had begun years earlier. First was a reconnaissance mission in 1584, and then again in 1585 by a crew of men including John White, who was in search of gold, pharmaceuticals, and a shortcut to the Pacific, in spite of the Spanish claims to North America. This crew went on in and then was forced to retreat after making enemies of the natives there. They ended up hitchhiking home with Sir Francis Drake less than a year after their arrival.
The actual settlement began with about 115 residents, including women and children, and was governed by John White, who had apparently decided to return despite his previous bad experience here. This time, being the apparently elected leader, John White was elected to sail back to England later that year to bring back a load of fresh supplies that the settlers needed to survive. White did in fact sail back to England, sadly leaving behind his wife, daughter, and an infant grandchild, Virginia Dare, who was the first English child born in the Americas. As luck would have it, he arrived to England only to find that war had broken out between Spain and his motherland, and that the ship he was supposed to return to America on, as well as every other available vessel, was ordered by Queen Elizabeth to be used in this war to face the Spanish Armada. So basically, all travel by ship from England was at a total halt, and he would not be able to return with those much-needed supplies that his colony was waiting for. Imagine the panic that would cause for a person to know that they wouldn't be able to return with the things that the people needed to survive. including his own family, and there was no way to tell them.
It would be 3 years, the summer of 1950, when John White would be able to return to Roanoke Island, just off the coast of what is now North Carolina. That is a very long time to go without supplies in a time when they were likely already struggling with rations and weather, as well as possibly unfriendly natives. Now, this is where the story gets interesting. I'm sure that most of you have heard the whole deal, and it's been depicted with very interesting interpretations in movies and television, one of Sam's favorites being American Horror Story, Roanoke.
And of course, me being me, I also liked the speculation about the happenings of Roanoke in the true historical fiction, it's not fiction, book, Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter.
I have to disagree. Roanoke was actually my least favorite season of American Horror Story. I felt like they could have done so much better with the idea of this than they did, and I was super disappointed in them turning it into a reality show situation. I hated it. And I'm ashamed to say that I've actually never seen Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter, although I've heard good things.
The book was much better than the movie. Anyway, moving forward with the facts of the mystery, John White, aboard the English ship the Hopewell, accompanied by a party of sailors, returned to his colony, or what he thought had been his colony, but there was no trace of the colony to be found, nor any of the inhabitants. I feel like he somewhat expected this. I'm sure his heart was in his stomach as they approached the colony, and he was hoping with all he was worth that they would still be there, alive. But alas, not so much. There was nobody found dead. There was just nobody. It's worth noting that according to an article in National Geographic, the men coming ashore pretty quickly happened upon what appeared to be fresh footprints in the sand, as well as a carving in the tree right by the shore. The carving had only three letters, C-R-O. There were very little indications of what may have happened there, but if the colonists were forced to abandon, they should have carved their destination into a tree or a nearby post using a prearranged code. If there had been an emergency evacuation of the colony, they would have carved a cross near the destination as well. These three letters made a little sense, as John White denied that it was a code that they had arranged to use before he left, and it was not the name of any settlement near there. But the party pressed on. They did end up finding something more, however. They found only a single word carved into a wooden post near the deserted settlement that read, Croatoan.
The carving itself did not appear to be made under distress, although the post was part of a defensive picket which had been put up after John White's departure. This is indicative of preparation by the settlers for an impending or expected attack of some form. They must have had some indication of danger or need for a defensive structure like this, but typically if a colony or settlement was attacked, there was always some evidence of this. People didn't just straight up disappear. And what was the word Croatoan about? Beyond this, there's nothing but theory and speculation as to the fate of the lost colony, and the investigations of this particular mystery have continued on for centuries with zero answer. Croatoan, it turns out, was the name of an island south of Roanoke that was the home to Native American tribes of the same name. It is a possibility that the Roanoke colonists were either murdered or abducted by said Native Americans. However, the Carolina Algonquin speakers were known to have been close allies to the Europeans. In fact, Manteo, one of the men of the native tribe, had twice been to London as a diplomat and been a guide and interpreter for the colonists. So it seems unlikely that he would just come and attack the settlement since they had been on friendly terms with them for a good length of time.
One could wonder if they had possibly run completely out of food and resources, facing starvation, and desperately tried to sail back to England. Maybe they had done this and become lost at sea, or perhaps they were massacred at the hands of the Spaniards who marched up from Florida. It's possible that they moved further inland and were maybe adopted by a friendly tribe of natives. Eventually, White had to give up looking for his family, or he would be left behind there by the ship and crew that brought him. Once again returning to England, White was never to return to the Americas, and the disappeared people from Roanoke were all but forgotten. Abandoned on foreign shores with no hope of rescue and no one to ever know the truth of their fate. In spite of the long-standing unsolved nature of the mystery, there is one theory that gives hope and even something to be thankful for. The lessons learned by those who settled at Roanoke may have helped to influence the next group of English settlers who would establish their own colony a mere 17 years later, just a short distance to the north at Jamestown.
And other than Roanoke, that is the early American colony that most catches my attention. Jamestown. It was the first permanent English colony established in North America. Jamestown was founded in 1607 in the month of May by 104 souls. Due to the climate of the region, drought, and inexperience of the settlers in growing crops, hunger and disease were a problem in Jamestown. Not to mention that they had just come out of months at sea, stuck on a boat. So their immune systems were shot, just like the pilgrims that had settled at Plymouth.
But that really isn't where the trouble began. From the beginning of the trip to America, things seemed destined for catastrophe. In December of 1606, the Virginia Company sent ships, the Susan Constant, Godspeed, and the Discovery, to North America to establish an English settlement. The settlement was to use their time upon first arriving not only to build the colony, but also to search for gold and silver deposits along with a suitable river trade route to the Pacific so that the trade with the Orient could be established. The first to arrive were all men and boys with different talents and trades that were to build what would later be the colony. It would be 9 months before any ladies showed up.
The girls never came.
Actually, I think there's a show on either Netflix or Amazon Prime or something I saw the other day called Jamestown, and it's about when the first women who arrived to the colony. I'm not sure about its historical accuracy, but it's on my queue.
The place looked perfect at first. It was basically an island right in the middle of the James River, which is more or less a swamp in that area. Aboard one of the ships was Captain John Smith, who we are all familiar with, whether it be from history class or the Pocahontas movie of our childhoods. Along the route, he had actually been imprisoned in the boat for insubordination. Apparently, he wasn't a very well-liked guy, really. Some of the journals from the voyage indicate that he was actually very arrogant and irritating.
So the colony was built and it consisted of a large wooden fort that housed a weapons and supply storage along with a church and several houses. That following summer, a captain by the name of Newport took two boats from the settlement back to England to give the king a report of what was going on in the new colony. I guess this was before passenger pigeons. He took two ships and 40 crew members with him.
I put that in there, like, snuck it. Said it so seriously.
Like a reporter.
Kaka!
Kaka! That's the distress signal.
Onward.
There were lots of natural resources, but it wasn't long into the trip back to England that they had realized that they had no source of fresh water near the settlement, as the water that they had been getting from the swamp had become contaminated.
Isn't standing swamp water just contaminated?
Yeah, and they were probably also pooping in it.
Like, how would they have not noticed?
They probably didn't even have a life straw.
Shields was closed, I imagine, due to COVID.
It's a long walk.
Yeah.
Especially when you're wearing a mask. By the time January rolled around, though, there was only 38 of the 104 original settlers still alive.
I don't think it would have been the mask that hindered them, but those funky hats they had going on.
I'd imagine they'd catch some wind.
Those hats probably carried the COVID up in there. Surrounding them as well was a close-by Algonquin tribe that was led by Chief Powhatan, who had reached a mutual agreement with John Smith in trade, which was great because the people in Jamestown really needed it at the time. They needed any supplies and help that they could get. The colonists and the Algonquins didn't always get along, but they were able to work together enough to trade for sustenance.
Later on, in 1609, Smith ended up taking a trip back to England. Pocahontas too.
Did she?
Yeah. There was a journal from his voyage.
You don't know.
Disney knows. Disney knows.
Did she go back in the movie?
Yeah.
God, it's been a while.
Anyway, the journal from the voyage documented some of the desperate goings-on within the new colony and why it wasn't really working out. He wrote that the first winter was extremely long and harsh and directly followed by drought. The colonists called it the starving time, yet again. People were killing their pets to eat them and eating the leather from their shoes to try to stay alive, and then their feet were cold, and that sucks.
I feel like they didn't think that through. Like, you'd eat it and be like, oh, God damn it.
That's horrible. Anyway, there was fractured leadership because the people were blaming each other, as well as constant killings by the Indians. One source said that two out of every three colonists were dying. John Smith had tried to fix things by trading goods for corn for the first 2 years, but he was making the Indians angry because he was apparently really disrespectful and rude, which doesn't really seem very smart when you're trying to feed desperate people and you need supplies, but whatevs.
Another journal entry found at the site of Jamestown was written by George Percy, who was standing in as leader while John Smith was away to England. Now, wasn't Percy in the Pocahontas movie? Or was that the dog? Because I thought the dog's name was Percy. Or was that our dog? We had a dog named Percy.
Did we?
It was that little pug. We had a pug and we named him Percy when we were little kids.
I think they named the dog Percy as a play on the guy that owned.
There was a Percy involved.
Was the pug named Percy?
So the dog's name was Percy.
Yes, the dog's name was Percy. But I think the governor...
It all ties in. So they did find another journal later at the site of Jamestown. And it was written by this George Percy, and he was standing in as leader while John Smith was gone to England. So he wrote, quote, "And now famine is beginning to look ghastly and pale in every face that nothing was spared to maintain life, to do those things which seem incredible, as to dig up dead corpses out of the graves and eat them. And some have licked up the blood which have fallen from their weak fellows," end quote.
John Ratcliffe, not George Percy. We were confused.
Okay, but I bet they named that dog after George Percy.
Perhaps.
That's how, you know, Disney's like that.
Kind of insulting.
They must not have had much respect for George Percy.
Yeek.
So imagine being so desperately starving, watching your family and fellow comrades waste away to nothing, and you know that you're all in for a very slow and painful death, if you're lucky enough to die before you have to watch all of your loved ones do so. It would put a person in a whole different frame of mind. They were so desperate that they went ahead and ate their dead. Not even all fresh dead. They pulled some of them out of the ground, and who knows how long they'd been there. They drank the blood of the dead for sustenance. They drank the blood of their ill comrades because they were too weak to protest.
This isn't just speculation. Well, it was until about 2012. Archaeologists at the site of Jamestown dug up a girl, and they called her Jane. They found her bones and a partial skull. She was about 14 years old. Prominent forensic anthropologists came to the conclusion that Jane likely died of something natural, but she had definitely been feasted on after she had died. Her brain had been eaten. Kuru! Someone got kuru.
Yeah, they did.
Inside of her skull, they found marks consistent with spoons nicking the bone. I don't know why I said it like that.
It was very melodic.
Made me cringe a little. The tongue, face meat, and leg muscles were also cut off of her and likely consumed. This was indicated by cut marks obviously made by a knife in these areas of the body. Cut marks like one would find on the bones of horses, pigs, and cows that had been butchered. How horrible.
But alas, there is hope on the horizon for the few who are left in this bleak and desolate place. The winter was over, thank God, and the first signs of spring in 1610 were starting to show. The weather was warming up and it was looking like the rest of them just might make it. Two ships came back to the colony just as it was about to be abandoned. Aboard these ships were 150 more settlers, more supplies, and Lord de la Warr, who was their new governor. De la Warr didn't last long. He took ill pretty soon after arriving and went back to England, leaving Thomas Gates to serve as governor. New laws were established, limiting trade and interaction with the colony's Indian allies. Not only did he limit the trade that had always been agreed to, they implemented raids against them, burning their houses and crops. 1611 was a good crop year for the Pilgrims. They had established a good crop of a new type of tobacco from seeds they obtained from the West Indies, and they had taken supplies from the Algonquins, and they were doing better. Settlements popped up along the James River now, and Jamestown was growing.
They did become more peaceful, too, after a local planter by the name of John Rolfe married Chief Powhatan's daughter, Pocahontas. But this didn't last long. Pretty much the only thing keeping the peace were Pocahontas and her father, but they both died in 1617 and 1618. This left the Algonquins under the rule of a far less tolerant leader who stirred the pot of hate and blended the colors of the wind and discontent towards the settlers. They were sick of these people who had came into their land and were constantly taking more land, taking their supplies, killing their people, and bringing their nutty disease. Bringing disease. So, the Indians retaliated and wiped out a chunk of the Jamestown settlers. King James of England needed to take control of the destruction of his fast-growing colony in America, so he made Virginia into a crown colony, with Jamestown the capital, and it continued to grow. Since they were a crown colony, they could expect certain protections from the English.
It wasn't over yet, though. That far less tolerant Algonquin chief at the time was forced to sign a treaty with the Jamestown colony that gave Virginia most of the Algonquin land, and then forced the natives to pay the colonial governor an annual tribute. Even a lot of the colonists were angry with their governor at this time because even though the tobacco trade and prices were dwindling, he kept upping the colonists' taxes. Not only this, but a few other tribes were fighting amongst themselves outside of the colony, so Governor Berkeley saw this as an obvious weakened state of the native affairs, and he took this opportunity to set up a meeting between the two under the guise of mediation. He convinced the two tribes to come so that he could try to help them solve their conflict. But instead of doing that, he used this meeting to murder both of the tribal chiefs. He then declared war on the Indians and forbid any further trade with them. The colony was only then allowed to trade with friends of the governor.
The volunteer militia was formed under Nathaniel Bacon in order to go wipe out some more of the Indians, and Governor Berkeley denied them commission to do so. So basically, Berkeley didn't want to pay the militia to kill a bunch of natives that the militia saw as a threat. Bacon and the militia decided to just be a volunteer group and went ahead and did it anyway. He was then named a rebel by the governor, and a large group of people who were loyal to Governor Berkeley turned against Bacon and his renegade militia group. So Nathaniel Bacon took his militia right back to Jamestown and raided it as well. This drove the governor out. They then ended the night in celebration by setting fire to the whole settlement. Jamestown was done. Today, the ghosts of the starving and desperate settlers of the Jamestown colony and the ones killed by natives in Bacon's rebellion are said to roam the land there.
With that warm, fuzzy tale ingrained in our souls, let's go back to our discussion on Thanksgiving and the origins and the traditions of the occasion, which encourages love and togetherness. Don't worry, there's still plenty of macabre shrouding this holiday. As I had mentioned earlier, there is some question as to the actual origin of the time-honored tradition. It is most commonly taught that the Pilgrims of Plymouth celebrated a feast with the natives, but it's argued that the origin of these celebrations began much earlier than that. An alternative account claims that the first Thanksgiving actually occurred in Virginia in 1619, 2 years before the party of Plymouth. This one included no food or friendly natives, just a group of settlers gathering to pray, and likely fasting, because this was a religious tradition in those times. Other sources claim that the natives were present in the original Jamestown celebration and that they had helped the settlers survive the winter. However, this celebration is said to have taken place at Berkeley Plantation, and this group of settlers included some survivors of the Jamestown starving time of 1609 and 1610, such as a man named Captain Woodleaf. The English Berkeley Company who funded the settlement gave orders for the yearly celebration of this day of Thanksgiving to the Almighty God, and for the next 2 years, they would do just that. In 1622, however, according to some sources, the Powhatan rebelled against the settlers' expansion into their territory and attempts to civilize them. They came to the settlement acting like they wanted to trade with the settlers, and then when everyone was comfortable, they set about their attack. They massacred everyone that they could find, men, women, and children. They attacked the settlement and killed 347 of the European settlers. The plantation was abandoned.
Let's take it back to Plymouth, though, shall we? 1621 was the year the festival occurred, but according to a New York Times article, it wasn't actually called Thanksgiving until the late 1830s. It is confirmed in historical documentation that the Plymouth celebration was a noteworthy cross-cultural celebration, which may have included a population of natives that more than doubled the number of pilgrims present. What isn't much acknowledged are the deadly conflicts that followed.
According to a source quoting a former chairman of the anthropology department at the University of Connecticut, William B. Newell, a Penobscot Indian, the first official Thanksgiving Day actually celebrated the massacre of 700 native men, women, and children while they were engaged in a religious ceremony, the annual Green Corn Dance, in the year 1637. Apparently, this was related to the discovery of a dead white man who was found in his boat, and the Pequot people were blamed for the murder and their villages burned to the ground in retaliation. They attacked the first village, trapping the Pequot people within the walls of their homes at Fort Mystic. They set the whole thing ablaze and killed the people who fled from the flames. The rest just died in the fire, women and children included.
The massacre was reportedly led by Mayor John Mason, who rallied his troops to burn the Pequot wigwams and then attack and kill hundreds more during the ceremony. Mason's report of the attack states, quote, "We must burn them. Such a dreadful terror let the Almighty fall upon their spirits that they would flee from us and run into the very flames. Thus did the Lord judge the heathen, filling the place with dead bodies." End quote. William Bradford, who was the governor of Plymouth, wrote at the time of the massacre, "Those that escaped the fire were slain with the sword, some hewed to pieces, others run through with their rapiers, so they were quickly dispatched and very few escaped. It was conceived that they thus destroyed about 400 at this time. It was a fearful sight to see them thus frying in the fire. Horrible was the stink and scent thereof, but the victory seemed a sweet sacrifice. And they gave the prayers thereof to God, who had wrought so wonderfully for them. He also wrote that for the next 100 years, every Thanksgiving Day ordained by a governor was in honor of the bloody victory, thanking God that the battle had been won. If you can even call that a win, but yeah.
So while Jamestown and Plymouth may be a partial source for the traditional celebration, by having joined the natives for dinner, the present celebration may be a mixture of more than one particular event. The truth of that matter is, Indians had observed autumn harvest celebrations for centuries. Pilgrims did not introduce the Native Americans to that tradition, and weren't even called pilgrims until the 1870s. They were, at that time, self-proclaimed religious separatists, according to some sources.
Obviously, we were told some of this in school, but a lot of the more macabre side of early American history weren't exactly detailed when we were children. And we've barely scratched the surface today on this show, but we hope you enjoyed hearing some of the more obscure facts about American colonial history that we have covered here. We appreciate you stopping by to listen to us, and we hope you'll tune in again next week for another weird and macabre episode. Don't forget, while you're sharing this time with your family this holiday season, to share the gift that is Bigfoot for breakfast with them as well. The gift that keeps on giving. If you have a show suggestion or really just anything to say, you can email us at bigfootforbreakfast@outlook.com, message us on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, or you can call us and leave a voicemail at 641-812-2635, and we'll play it on our next episode. We'll be back next week, and we hope you will too.
Come at me, bro.